Hey, good day there. Welcome to another episode of the Typewriter video series. This is Joe Van Cleve, and today we're going to talk about picking favorites. Stay tuned. Having a typewriter collection is a lot like having a dozen kids. How do you pick a favorite kid? Well, truth be told, some people who come from large families will tell you that mom always had her favorite, but when it comes to typewriters, and if you're a collector like I am, it's really hard to pick one favorite typewriter over another. Not that you really have to, but if you had to prioritize your collection, what would you keep and what would you get rid of and why? If you wanted to focus your collection on just certain types of machines, what characteristics would you choose? Another way of looking at it is, what would be your desert island machine? That is, you're stranded on an island and you could only have one typewriter because, with few exceptions, typewriters don't float. So does it sound like I'm thinking about downsizing my collection? No, not at all. Am I suggesting you should do the same if you're a typewriter collector? No, not necessarily. But what I am curious about is, what are your favorite machines from each category of typewriter? So I'm going to kind of share with you in this video what my favorite machines are. And I'm going to use these arbitrary categories of ultra portable, medium-sized portable, and there's a third category which I will call roughly World War II or earlier, older typewriters. Now, you notice in these three categories, and yes, they are arbitrary, but you notice I've purposefully left out electric typewriters and full upright typewriters. The reason being is, first of all, in my personal experience, I've never owned any full upright typewriters. And secondly, I only have one electric typewriter in my possession, so I can't really speak about the entire genre. But of those three arbitrary categories, ultra portables, medium-sized portables, and older typewriters, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what my preferences are. When you think about preferences for typewriters, there's a lot of different ways to look at this. For some people, it's all about the aesthetics of the machine, the way it looks, its shape, and its color. For other people, like myself, it's more about the functionality of the typewriter, how well it works. And for this reason, it often comes down to individual preferences for individual machines. An example would be, I have two Hermes 3000 typewriters, both from the 1970s. One works slightly better than the other, so I might have a preference for not just that one brand and model, but I might have a preference for an individual machine as well. But for other people, that you might have a different kind of a set of criteria for how you judge your favorite typewriter. I'm going to just share with you today how I feel about the typewriters that I've personally experienced. Now, keep in mind that I have not experienced or had personal experience with every kind of typewriter out there. So there are some machines which I'd like to believe would be my favorites, like Groma Calibris. I would love to have one. I've heard good things and bad things about them, but I would love to have that kind of an ultra portable machine. But I'm going to stick with what I know to be true from my own experience. So for the first category of typewriter, we're going to cover ultra portables. Now, keep in mind, with ultra portable typewriters, there are intrinsic compromises that have been made with those machines in order to fit them into such a small package and a lightweight package. So there are some intrinsic features that might be missing from these typewriters that you might see on more full-size typewriters. You'll also find that in most cases, the feel of the typing action is not as nice as on bigger machines, simply because of the limitations of space brought about by the small size. And in many cases also, when these typewriters were sold new, ultra-portable typewriters were generally less expensive, and so obviously they would have less features. But keeping that in mind, for this category of typewriter, not as feature-filled, not as aesthetic or as functional as a bigger typewriter. I'm going to cover the ones that I've known in my experience. So the two best ultra portables in my collection right now, I think, are both Japanese of manufacture. One is the Webster XL747, which is made by Brother, and the other is the Royal Mercury, which is made by Silver Seiko. Now, I have another ultra-portable typewriter that's even smaller, and that is a Hermes Rocket. It is actually a really good machine, and it's really difficult for me not to pick it as my favorite ultra-portable. But I'll tell you, there's one reason why I haven't, and that's because on my particular version, there's a mechanical weakness in the lever system that disengages the rack gear from the escapement, basically the carriage release lever. And that lever is soft metal and it tends to bend under its own force, and it causes the escapement to skip. And for that reason, I don't count it as highly as the other machines I mentioned earlier. For every other reason, though, as an ultra portable, I would count it as the top because of its size, and it has pretty darn good typing action for as small as it is. But the two I did pick are both Japanese. They're the Webster XL747 and the Royal Mercury. Let's take a look at those. I should also mention that I also have a Brother Charger 11, very similar to this Webster XL747, but it just the Charger has less features. But for this Brother-made typewriter, the thing about these Japanese typewriters, there's good and there's bad. Let's cover the bad parts first. The bad part, the worst part about them is the touch, the feel of the keys is rather heavy. There is a heavy force required throughout the keystroke. And it's not like a mid-1950s Smith Corona where there's something to do with the leverage of it that once the key starts moving, the type bar really flies. You have to apply pressure throughout the entire stroke on these typewriters. So they're a little bit more of a heavy feel to them, and maybe slightly mechanical, tinny, clanky sounding, but really that's not too bad. That's really about the only complaint I have for this typewriter. Let's talk about the good parts. The build quality. Everything about this, the bodies are all metal. Okay, even the back, the bottom panel is all covered, so you can put it on your lap safely without worrying about getting oil stains on your pants or interrupting the operation of the machine. The ribbon cover is metal. And the color on this particular one, this robin's egg blue with the red tab key and the repeat spacer. So these typewriters, all of these ultra portables that I've seen, almost all of them, they only have a single carriage release lever. It's on the right platen knob, so there is one disadvantage there. This one has tabs, but they're fixed tabs. You can't set them, so there's fixed tab slugs in the back here. But one of the features that I absolutely love about this machine is the repeat spacer. And that is a great feature. I wish all typewriters had that. Because especially in a typewriter like this where you don't have a carriage release lever on the left platen knob, where if you want to move, after you've done a correction, let's say, and you want to move the carriage back to where you were before, you would have to otherwise reach up with your right hand and move the carriage manually, or sit there and space one at a time to move it, where the repeat spacer just makes it so much quicker. And it is nice having the tabs preset as they are, and that is a nice compromise. The thing that I love about this size machine is its size. Now, this one comes in a soft case with a really good handle, and the zipper is in pretty good shape as compared to the Olivetti Letters, where the zipper is almost always rot out and break. But this typewriter is small enough to put inside of a messenger bag, a shoulder bag, and you literally can carry it anywhere on your person. That's true with this one, that's true of the Royal Mercury as well. And it is a decent enough machine to have really good typing experience once you get used to it. It is a great lap typing machine. Now this particular one also, being a newer style machine from the 1970s, it has the number one key with an exclamation mark. So that's another little advantage to it compared to the older ones. But I really love this machine. Oh, it has a touch selector, high and low, the touch selector. Not all portables have that, right? So pretty decent machine. I really rate it pretty highly. I love this. As for an ultra portable, you can't go wrong with this machine. Well, this second ultra-portable that I would call a keeper was a close toss-up between this and the Hermes Rocket. But this Royal Mercury, made in Japan by Silver Seiko, I really believe to be right up there with the brother. Let's talk about what it lacks. It doesn't have any tab buttons, any tab function, and it doesn't have the repeat spacer. And of course, it doesn't have the pretty blue, robin's egg blue color, and it's a little more boxy in appearance, in shape, than the little curvy brother. But what it does do, I think, better than the brother is it has a nicer touch. It has a softer touch. And I know from having used this typewriter over the years, I got this probably back about 2005, maybe, time frame. This has been a really reliable machine, makes a great imprint. It's a 10 character per inch typeface. It has been out to California two or three times on vacation with me. It's been my beach typer. It's been out on the beach typing. It has a hard plastic clamshell that covers it with a handle, and it's sealed up on the bottom, so it is very rugged and durable, and it's small enough to put into a messenger bag, just like the brother. I really love it. It is you can't beat the mechanical reliability, and it's a pretty darn good touch for such a small typewriter. It does have the high-low touch selector. What this has interesting about it is on the line spacing selector, above the single line spacing is a dot. And what that does is that is the lock for the carriage. And then below the two line spacing is a zero, and that releases the ratcheting for the platen so you can adjust the vertical position, for instance, for typing within form. So I thought it was a rather unusual place to put the carriage lock lever right on the line spacing selector. But this has been a really good, reliable machine. And it's, as I said at the beginning of this video, because I tend to so highly value typewriters that are reliable mechanically, this is one of the reasons why I would choose this over the Hermes Rocket. The next category of typewriter I'd like to talk about are the medium-sized portables. Now, here, when you're talking medium-sized portables, all of a sudden, your choices become much wider because there are so many good medium-sized typewriters out there, from the Olympias to the Hermes to Smith Coronas and a lot of others I can't mention hardly, you know, keep in my mind. But so I can only speak about the ones that I've personally owned. I know what a lot of people in the typosphere and the typewriter bloggers say, but I'm going to speak just from my own experience. So let's look at two of the ones I think that are pretty highly rated in my own experience. This first medium-sized portable that I would recommend highly is the Smith Corona Silent series. This particular specimen is a Silent Super. Actually, I have another one that's a Silent, a non-super version. It specifically is a little bit more reliable only because it's had an easier life. This one came out of a super grungy situation, but it's a beautiful typewriter, and it's I've been servicing it and getting it back into shape. But so what is so good about these typewriters? Well, there's a number of things I really love about these Smith Coronas from the 1950s. First of all, they're not really that wide. I would say, I haven't taken a tape measure to it, but they're probably, might even be slightly narrower than those two ultra portables, certainly no wider. And they are certainly taller, right? It has this, what I would call a 1950s shape to it. It looks like the automobiles of the 1950s, which my dad used to call upside down bathtubs on wheels. You know, that kind of rounded, curved 1950s look that you can definitely see the styling there. And also the color, right? These were kind of drab office tools, right? Gray crinkle finish. I think they're being pretty bold with the green keys and the nice green Smith Corona placard there and the nice stripes. But what's good about these machines, spectacularly good, first of all, is the touch. These typewriters have a great touch. And there's something about the linkages between the key and the type bar where the keys stay horizontal. The surface of the key stays horizontal during its travel. And the linkages are super tight. There's hardly any play between the surface of the key and the type slug itself. So everything is mechanically really tight. They designed the leverage of the type linkage so that you get a really good hard force without exerting too much finger pressure. And then second thing that's really beautiful about these machines is one of the best machines I've ever seen for the carriage return line advance lever. It is long. It reaches out almost to the front of the ribbon cover, and it's low. It sits in profile right along the shape of the ribbon cover there, and it's just elegantly designed. It doesn't stick way high up in the air. It's right there for your hand to reach. So everything about it is designed for ergonomics. It has two carriage release levers, one behind each platen knob. What differentiates the Silent from the Silent Super model primarily has to do with the Silent Super has tab set and clear keys over here. And it has, I think, a little bit nicer action. The only difference I've really seen mechanically between the two is on the escapement cog, there is a little spring-loaded dampening pulley mounted to the shaft of it that the non-super version doesn't have. While we have the machine tipped over underneath, I'll show you that one of the other great things about this series of typewriters is the escapement mechanism is right there, easy to access for maintenance. Everything is right there. However, the downside to that is you cannot easily put it on your lap for typing because you might get oil on your pants and the folds of fabric of your pants might interfere with the mechanism. So I really recommend typing on your lap with the typewriter attached to the bottom base of the case, which is detachable from the top of the case. It has a hard case. So Smith Corona Silent, Silent Super, any of these Smith Coronas from the 1950s are absolutely wonderful medium-sized typewriters. And in my experience has been even this severely abused typewriter has such a great feel to it. So these are, in my view, they're really highly rated. I really love these things and can't say enough good about them. As I said earlier, it was difficult for me to choose between all the medium-sized portables for what is my own personal preference. But I would have to say that along with the Smith Corona Silence from the 1950s, I would have to say any of the Hermes 3000s are wonderful typewriters. This particular example of a Hermes 3000, I have two of these. It's a 1970s style boxy plastic case body style. But this is the Naked Writer, or the Naked Writer. And the difference between naked and naked is if you're naked, you're up to no good. But I've taken the chassis out of the case and I mounted it to this block of wood because I really think it makes the typewriter look smaller than it does otherwise. The plastic body shell, it's a lot bigger and boxier and bulkier. And it has that kind of 1970s angular style, so to speak. But what I love about these Hermes 3000s, first of all, is the build quality. And secondly, I think of all the typewriters that I have in my collection, none are as good as the Hermes 3000 when it comes to the typing action, the typing feel. I would say it's a real close matchup between a Hermes 3000 and a Smith Corona Silent, but really I think the Hermes 3000 takes it. One thing I don't like as well on the Hermes is the position of the carriage return line advance lever, which as you can see sticks up quite a bit more. It is long, it's plenty long. It reaches out to almost the top row of buttons, but it's quite a bit higher up than the carriage return lever on the Smith Corona Silent, so it's not quite as easy to reach, but it's pretty long nonetheless. One of the other things you begin to appreciate about the aesthetics of the Hermes 3000, especially when you take it out of its body, is this kind of interesting curve to the type bar segment. How elegant looking is that? And it's obvious that they've done something with the linkages and whatnot in the engineering of the machine to get it to look like that. But it was obviously not an aesthetic choice. I think it was obviously an engineering decision, but it really is cool. It has a row of buttons up on top, this backspacer. This is your tab set, tab clear, clear all the tabs, margin release, and of course the tab button itself. It has a 5-position touch selector, and it has a 3-position ribbon color selector along with the stencil position where it doesn't raise the ribbon at all. Another unique feature about these is it has a ribbon indicator inside the paper bale that moves as you move the margin setting, and it tells you with a red indication where your margins are set to, which is a really interesting feature. It is a little intricate mechanically, but it works really well. This machine is also nice because the rubber rollers on the paper bale are large enough in diameter that the paper will feed underneath it evenly when you first feed a sheet in without having to manually lift it up. So it's kind of nice that way. It's a medium-sized machine, so there's a little more features to it, and it certainly has a much better ergonomics, and especially the touch on this machine. These really are workhorse machines, and if you had to have just one desert island medium-sized portable, this would be one of them to have, along with the Smith Corona Silent series, of course. But I've kind of broken my rule because I'm going to pick one more, a medium-sized portable, as a must-have. Yeah, I know I said we were only going to have two typewriters from every category, and I broke my rule now because how can you not keep this one on the desert island as well? And this is the Swedish-made Fawcett 1620. And I just got this a few months ago, and I didn't really know much about these, hardly ever heard of them. The first thing, that the most notable thing about this typewriter is this cylindrical tube is the bearing race for the carriage bearings. And it is absolutely the quietest and smoothest carriage bearings I've ever felt on any typewriter. The second thing about it, it has a really good touch to it. Maybe not quite as good as the Hermes or the Smith Corona, but it's way up there. Thirdly, all the body panels, they're not stamped metal, they're cast aluminum alloy. Cast aluminum alloy. So a really high build quality. I don't know if it's fair to call it a Volvo of typewriters, but this typewriter mechanically has been one of the most reliable typewriters that I've ever found used anywhere. It absolutely has virtually no problems, no matter how I type, how hard I type, how fast I type, has extremely good mechanical reliability. I really like the long protruding platen knobs. It makes it easier to grab a hold of. And of course, the more modern 1970s styling, this kind of long platen knob does kind of remind me of something like an IBM Selectric, but of course it's a lot smaller machine. It's not nearly as light, of course, as an ultra portable, but it does have a clamshell two-piece plastic case that it fits in. You could probably lug it to your desert island, but I certainly think it's a great machine. Maybe not quite as many accoutrements as a Hermes 3000, but it does have one thing that's interesting. It has a tab set and clear lever here, and it has another tab set and clear lever here. One of these levers is for universal tab and set, tab set and clear. The other lever on the other side is every 10 spaces there is a preset tab that you can activate. So two different tab systems operating at once. So that makes it a really interesting machine. It is a newer style keyboard. It's an American style keyboard. It has the number one, the exclamation mark, the plus and equals, and of course, a really full-featured tab system. So a really neat typewriter. I've been very impressed with the mechanical reliability and the feel of the carriage as it moves. So I would say that I'd have to have this third typewriter in my collection of medium-sized portables. Now, my third and final category of typewriters that I would consider keeping if I had to get rid of everything else are the older machines. Now, I've had two other older machines. I've had a 1936 Underwood Universal, which was a basically great machine, very reliable, typed pretty good, just never inspired me. I don't know why. And then I had an old 1920s Corona 4. It was a beautiful, beautiful looking typewriter, but it just never typed really well. It was a little too old. But then last year I got this Corona Standard made in about 1948. And this is probably the one typewriter that I would choose from all of the older World War II era and earlier typewriters. How can you argue with its appearance? It has this flat top of the ribbon cover that really reminds me of kind of a baby grand piano. And in keeping with that motif, of course, yes, you're going to want to have your candelabra on there anytime you're using this. Now, this is a little toy candelabra from the dollhouse furnishings of a hobby store. And I put a magnet on the bottom, and then there's a piece of tape on the bottom of the magnet so the magnet doesn't scratch the beautiful shiny finish on this 1948 typewriter. The gentleman I bought this from was a biochemist, or is a biochemist, at the University of New Mexico. His dad bought this in 1948 to go to school, and then he used it in the 1970s when he went to school, and the last time this machine had ever been used was in 1980, and so it sat in the closet for 36 years until I bought it from him. And so it has the Corona, Smith Corona feel to it. I would say it's probably not quite exactly the same as a Smith Corona Silent in feel, but it's almost the same. And I gotta say, for an older style typewriter with this black shiny finish and the round keys with a nickel trim, this has a modern feel. What I mean by modern is the height of the typewriter era. This feels really good. It's a 10 character per inch. It types really well. It's very reliable. It has a very good even quality of imprint, very smooth. The decals on the machine are extraordinarily good shape. It comes with a hard case, and so certainly you would want to have this typewriter on the desert island. And of course, who could go without the floating shift, right? Floating shift, which really was revolutionary for that day and age. But this is my desert island typer from the older types of typewriters. And of course, don't forget the candelabra. Well, that was it. That was my own personal estimation of which machines in my collection I would keep and which I would maybe consider not keeping. Keep in mind, as I said earlier, that I have not owned or experienced every make or model of typewriter out there. So there may be some wonderful machine I have yet to experience, which is another good reason to keep collecting. But if you are going to keep collecting, you're also going to have to pare down your selectivity. Otherwise, you will be losing that sense of domestic tranquility, if you know what I mean. So it was an interesting comparison. You might think, why would you want to keep those little brother typewriters when you have that beautiful Corona Standard or the other Hermes 3000 in your collection? Well, again, ultra portables serve a different purpose from medium-sized machines, I believe. They truly are the laptops of the typewriter world. They are portable. You can take them in a shoulder bag. So there are certain compromises you have to make in regards to features and sophistication in order to have that portability. So this is why I have three categories of typewriter. And again, as I said at the outset, I'm not including full-size upright typewriters because I simply don't have any in my experience or collection right now. And I'm hoping that you guys will comment down below if you're a typewriter collector, if you have any number of typewriters in your collection, comment down below about what you think are the best typewriters you've experienced and which ones do you think you'd like to own. Okay, until next time, you guys have yourselves a great day.